Shalom Aleichem. We are, this week's parasha is Parashat Vayeira. In Parashat Vayeira, we just came out of Parashat Lech Lecha, whenever Avraham Avinu had to leave his hometown. And now, finally, he does the mitzvah of Brit Milah. Right before, in the previous parasha, we had the mitzvah of Brit Milah that Avraham Avinu, from now on, his descendants have to do Brit Milah. Ishmael was not included in that because he was born before. He's not included. The Muslims, the Arabs, they don't have to do Brit Milah. They have no mitzvah of Brit Milah. But the ones that are born after, they have a mitzvah of Brit Milah. That's why the Jews do Brit Milah in the eighth day. So he does the Brit Milah, and this is his third day now. The beginning of this week's parsha in Genesis 18 starts on the third day of Avraham Avinu's recovery from the Brit Milah, from the circumcision. And it starts that Hashem appeared to him in the plains of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance of the tent in the heat of the day. So today we have the third day of Avraham Avinu's recovery. It's the third day right after he just did the circumcision. It's one of the In the end, it's a procedure that Avraham Avinu actually had to do for himself. He had to do it for himself. He didn't have someone else do it for him. He did it to himself. And in the end, it was in a part, it was in a place that's a very sensitive place. And this is his third day recovering. And the third day, as we know, is it's the hardest day. Because, yeah, it's right on the time you feel a pain. But then after a few days, you start having problems. You start in the end, all the antibodies and all the things start going over. So it starts hurting. Anytime you have some type of recovery period, the third day is always the hardest day. Suddenly, it technically also, for example, if someone has the third year of his even tshuva, someone did tshuva, and then 3 years later, sometimes Hashem sends you tests that's going to challenge it. It's going to challenge that your tshuva. And let's say you've been good for the for 33 years, and this is your third year. Hashem sends you tests, sends you things. If you're learning, do you really want to learn your whole life? Do you really want to go? Do you even want to learn right now, or do you want to go work? People are gonna start giving you different types of jobs. You want to do this? No, I want to do this. I want to sit and learn. You want to do this? Hashem is going to send you. Or it's going to be start becoming difficult. The Yetzer Hara is going to start coming and say, listen, wake up later. Don't learn right now. Or all these type of things. Or you could chill. You could chill for now. You don't actually have to learn. Go learn in an hour. Go learn in this. And then wasted the whole entire day. Or it could be with the tshuva, that someone is guarding his eyes for so long. And then things start becoming much harder for him. So he has to strengthen himself. It's always the third time is always the hardest. It's always the time that you have to push, try harder. So today's the third day and Avraham Avinu is recovering. And so Hashem comes over to Avraham. He comes to Avraham and he is doing bikur cholim. Bikur cholim, as we know, you have to if someone is sick, if there's someone that's sick, you have to go and visit him, see how he's doing, see what he needs help with. Don't just go say hi, how are you, how's everything, what's with you, and okay, off you, do better, okay, goodbye. You have to ask him, do you need something? Maybe maybe the nurses are not over here, not helping you so much. So you go and you help, you want water, you want food. I know that the hospital food is not the best food. You want actual food. You want something that tastes good. Some food. Something that's not there. You want to read something. You want a sefil maybe. You want some type of reading material. You want something. Do you want anything that you're not getting right now? That's what Bikur Cholim. Bikur Cholim is to visit the sick people whenever they're sick to make them feel better. Chachamim actually explained that whenever someone goes to do Bikur Cholim, to visit sick people, they take away 1/60th of the person's sickness. Now in the end, if even a million people come, it's never going to get rid of the sickness, because it's always going to be 1/60th, 1/60th. Even if you have only 1%, it's going to be only 60% as a 60th. But in the end, Chachamim are explaining that you are taking away 1/60th of his pain, of his suffering, of his, you know, of his sickness. So you are making him feel better. So they're saying, they're saying go, and it's a very big mitzvah. It's making someone feel better. So Hashem Yitbarach is coming to teach us this importance of Bikur Cholim. He's coming and saying, I am doing this myself. I love Avraham, and I'm coming, I'm trying to show my love to him. Hashem himself comes to Avraham, as it says, Hashem appeared to Avraham. It doesn't actually sound like it connects to any of the other things, because right away it says that he saw the people from afar. Doesn't say, we don't see that Hashem spoke to him right away, right after this. Just Hashem came to him, and then Avraham saw people. It sounds like there's nothing, no connection. But the Chachamim explained to us there's a connection, because Hashem came to visit the sick. Rashi says he came to visit Avraham whenever he was chole. So now, Hashem wanted Avraham Avinu to rest. He wanted him to rest, to have a rest day, to have a day for himself. Meaning do whatever he has to do, whatever it is. But Avraham Avinu every single day would always have the tradition to have people every single day, to have guests at his home every single day. But today, why should today be any different? He says, I'm looking for guests, I'm looking. So Hashem said, I'm going to make it a very hot day so that no one's going to come. So Avraham is going to say, you know what, I want to, I tried. Seder. In the end, there's no people coming. There's no guests. Okay, fine. I tried. I did what I had to do. I did my ishtadlut. And Hashem said no. But even though Hashem says no, and there is a lot of heat, so that people are not going to come outside, Avraham Avinu still wants to do it. This is the thing with Avraham Avinu that we have to learn. That Avraham Avinu, even though, as we know, if someone has a mitzvah, he has to do an obligation. He has an obligation. For example, he has to put on tefillin. Or he has to, you know, do brit milah for his son. Or he has to, you know, some type of thing. He has to do it. He has to shake a lulav. Lulav and etrog. He has to do these type of things. So all these type of things, if you could do, you do everything you can to do it. I need to put on tefillin. But chas v'shalom, if you have someone that doesn't have an arm, doesn't have arms, then he can't put the arm on. He could put the head, he should put the head, but he can't put the arm, he doesn't have an arm. What are you going to say to Hashem? Hashem, you know, I want to do the mitzvah, but you took it away from me. Okay, good, Baruch Hashem, I don't have to do it. No, you have to have in your heart, you have to say, Hashem Yitbarach, you know, in deep in my heart, that if I had an arm, I would put it on my arm. But I don't have an arm, so I can't put it on my leg. So because of that, Hashem says, some things you want to do, I'm going to tell you no, I'm going to put a thing. There's actually a Gemara in Masechet Avodah Zarah. In the beginning, in Dav Bet, going on to Gimel, it explains how the Goyim are going to come to HaKadosh Baruch Hu in the end of days, the Goyim, the Rishayim, the Rishayim part of the Goyim, that they're going to come, they're going to say, we want reward. Hashem is going to say, did you do anything? Say, no, yeah, we did this and this and this, and we did all this for Bnei Yisrael. Hashem is going to say, Shotim Sheba Olam, you didn't do anything, you did all for yourself. And they say, can you please give us something? No, what do you mean? You work before Shabbat, then you have something to eat on Shabbat. If you work in this world, then you're going to have what to eat in the next world. Then you're going to have the next world. You're going to have a place in the next world. But if you didn't work before Shabbat, you're not going to have anything to eat on Shabbat. If you didn't work before the world to come, which is considered the seventh day, the seventh millennium, you didn't work in this world, which is the sixth millennium, you can't eat on Shabbat, you can't eat in the world to come, you can't enjoy from the world to come. There's no world to come for you. So Hashem says, but to see if you're really legit, there's one mitzvah, a very easy mitzvah called sukkah. All you don't have to do, you just have to put some nice boards, make kosher sukkah, and sit in it. That's all you have to do. Sit and eat. What's the big deal? You don't have to do anything. You just go walk inside, sit down and eat. That's all you have to do. So they were like, yeah, why not? Let's do this. Hashem makes that day hot. He makes it hot. And what do? They give up instantly. And what do? They don't just leave. Because in the Gemara it says, what do you mean? If they left, that's it. They're partur. They don't have to do it. They're not obligated to do it anymore. They could go home, no problem. But what do? Whenever they leave the sukkah, they don't just leave. They leave it and they kick the sukkah and then leave. Basically saying, we don't need this garbage, we don't need anything, we're out. So Hashem sees this is not middat of Avraham Avinu. Us the Jews, we have the middat of Avraham Avinu. If it's hot on Sukkot, we say, what can we do? It's hot. In the end, if we stay out here, we're gonna die with this heat wave. But in the end it said, or if it's raining, we say maybe we could wait until it drips inside, then we have to go inside, whatever, okay, we'll go inside. And then we have to enjoy our meal. And that's the thing. If you're patur, you're patur. You don't have to do it. You're allowed to go home. But the thing is, how do you feel? How do you feel automatically whenever you can't do it? Hashem says no, and you go inside. How do you feel? Do you feel like, thank God I didn't want to be in there, I'm going to go to my house with the AC? Or you're going to go, or with the heat, wherever, if it's hot or cold, wherever you are. In New York, it's cold. In Israel, it's hot. So, do you go inside feeling a broken heart, or you go inside feeling happy? So, Hashem says, I want to let Avraham rest. I'm not going to bring him guests. But Avraham Avinu is with a broken heart. He says, I will do anything, I will do everything to have guests. Even in the heat, I will stay outside in the heat waiting for guests. Waiting. Hashem sees Avraham is not giving up. So what am I going to do? I'm going to send them angels disguised as men. Now, as we know, sometimes Hashem says, you have mitzvot, but there's a mitzvah that you can do, but in the end, I'm not going to give you this mitzvah, because in the end, I know a deeper reason of why I'm not giving it to you. For example, Hashem could give a person a daughter instead of a son. Firstborn is going to be a daughter. But what's the problem? It's no problem. Having a firstborn girl is great. But the problem is, the thing is, there's no pidyon haben. Pidyon haben is only for the firstborn. And right now, maybe later, but right now there's no brit milah. There's no brit milah. So you're saying, Hashem, I want to do the mitzvah. Hashem says, no, not now. Or in the case of the pidyon haben, not for you. Not in this lifetime. Or if you want to, I want to be a kohen. Why? Because I want to do berkat kohenim. Hashem says, not in this lifetime, not for you. I'll pay any money. No, I'm sorry, it's not happening. So what do we have to do? Do everything we can in avodat Hashem. So Hashem sends him three malachim. And before he sends him three malachim, it says over here in the first verse, what does it say? That Hashem appeared to Avraham Avinu in the plains of Mamre. Now the question is, Rashi and Chachamim ask, he says, why does it say in Elonei Mamre, in the plains of Mamre? What's so special about Mamre? Mamre was a person that the plains were named after him. And he was a person that was good friends with Avraham Avinu. Rashi explains why did Hashem show up over there to greet Avraham? Because Mamre did something special. What did he do? Rashi explains, because Avraham Avinu went to Mamre and asked him for advice about the Milah, and Mamre gave him advice for the Milah. So Hashem says, you give him advice pro the Milah, pro doing brit Milah, then I'm gonna give you zchut to appear in your land. In Rav Nissim Yagin's book, it's called The Majesty of Shabbat. The Majesty of Shabbat, in the 9th chapter, it explains how what Mamre did. In the Midrash, Bereshit Rabbah, 42:8, it explains how Avraham Avinu came to Mamre. He came to Mamre. It also says that he had three friends. He had three friends. One was called Aner, one was called Eshkol, and one Mamre. He came over to Aner. He says, what should I do? He asked all three. Aner first was the first one to answer. He says, listen, you're old. You're 90 years old. You're going to make yourself weaker right now. Are you crazy? You have enemies. Eshkol says, you're going to put yourself in such a big risk right now. You have enemies. They're going to come. They're going to kill you instantly. Right away, like very, very easily, because you're going to be weak. Mamre says, listen, who told you to do this? Abraham says, Hashem told me to do this. So he says, the same Hashem, the one that whenever you were in Kivshan HaEsh, whenever you were in the fire, he saved you. And the same one that's the God of heaven and earth, the God of everything, the God that created all of us, he tells you to do something, you're not going to do it? So Avraham says, you're right, I'm going to do it. Now, a deeper thing that it says, now the question is, what does that mean? Avraham in every other test doesn't ask anybody, Hashem says I'm doing it, but this test, he asks Mamre. Mamre, that's not a Jew, that's not an anything, he just asks him, what do you mean, should I do it or not? This is one of the biggest foundations of Judaism. This is one of the biggest mitzvot ever. That if someone doesn't do it, how it says, V'nichita ha-nefesh me'ameh, you cut off from your nation. Avraham Avinu would have been cut off. You'd be cut off from the nation and also from the world to come. This is the craziest thing, how to even think about this. So what does this mean? Midrash explains that at the time Avraham Avinu was doing Kiruv. He was trying to bring people back, bring people to monotheism, to believe in Hashem, and not just into monotheism, to believe in Hashem, that of the seven Noahide laws. Because in the back in the day there was no Judaism yet. So they didn't have to keep mitzvot. But what did they have to keep? They had to keep the seven Noahide laws. And he was bringing people, he was saying, teaching them, they were doing idolatry, and he was teaching them the right path until he gained a lot of students. And he says, what does he say? He goes over to Mamre, and he says, you know, Baimet, if I do this, and people hear of it, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? Nowadays, they come to my house, they learn and they grow, they come to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But if I do this, what are they going to say of me? They're going to say, this guy is fanatic. This guy is insane. He did, what is he doing? He's mutilating himself. Are you out of your mind? Forget it. This guy is not normal. I'm not going to listen to him. So the question that he asked Mamre, he says, if I do it in public, they're going to think I'm crazy. So maybe I should do it in private. I'm going to do the will of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but I'm going to make it private. I'm going to make it private. I'm going to do it quietly. Nobody's going to know. And then they can still come to my house. They're never going to know what's going to know. But in the end, if I do it publicly, I'm publicly showing that I'm doing the will of God. So Mamre said, if HaKadosh Baruch Hu told you to do it publicly for everybody to know. Everybody has to know. Invite everybody. Hashem tells you to do it, doesn't make a difference what people say. Don't care what he says, he says, she says. People are going to talk. People are going to talk regardless of what it is. If they're true people of God, if they're true seekers of truth, they're going to accept it. But even if they're not, who cares? And in Bereshit Rabbah 46:3, it says that in the end, Hashem, Avraham Avinu did it. He did it publicly. People know about it. But Avraham was worried. He says, now, what are they going to think of me? What are they going to do? Is people going to come? Am I going to be able to make more Baalei Tshuvot? How am I going to do it? What am I going to do? Avraham Avinu comes and says, What does he say? He says, I see you're afraid that the Brit will separate you between you and the Goyim. He says, I see. I know you're afraid that you're going to be separated from people. People are going to look at you like crazy. What does HaKadosh Baruch Hu tell him right after? He says, Avraham Avinu, you're missing the point. What is the Brit Milah? It's the thing to make a Brit, a covenant between me and you, between me and the nation of Israel. If this disconnects from the Goyim, from the Gentiles, that's the point. That's the point. You're not supposed to be with the people. You're a special person. You're going to be the forefather of the Jewish people. You are different. You're not the same as everybody else. You're not... Anybody that's a Jew has to understand that you're not just someone that was born in a family that's called Jews that everybody hates. You are a special person. You have a special purpose. So Hashem is saying to Avraham, you're supposed to be separate. You're supposed to be separate. You're not supposed to be among the people. You're supposed to be separate. That's the point. That's the point. This is also a thing. This is also a musal that a lot of people, whenever they do tshuva, whenever they're starting to do tshuva, the people are saying, listen, don't do tshuva. Why are you doing this? You have good friends. You have good family. You get everything. If you do tshuva, everybody's going to leave you. Nobody's going to want to hang out with you. What is HaKadosh Baruch Hu saying? Good! Leave them! It's the best thing. If in the end, you're going to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and your friends, they want to come, come, come. We're still going to be friends together. We're going to do everything together. Learn together. Grow together. Everything. But if you're going to go against God, you're going to go against of what I believe, you're not my friends anymore. Goodbye. What do you want from me? So this is what HaKadosh Baruch Hu is saying. This is the whole entire reason why Hashem came to Elonei Mamre. Why? Because Mamre gave him the advice, do it in public. Do it for every person to see. Pursue Menisa, completely making it publicize the thing that happened to you. Publicize what you did. Even though people are going to think, are you crazy? Are you out of your mind? What's wrong with you? Say, this is what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants. I'm letting everybody know. Everybody know. You don't have to do it in private. Being worried about it. Being, you know, embarrassed about it. Show that you're happy about it. If you're a Jew, you get a nice big kippah. Big one. Scream it to the world. Dance on Simchat Torah. Show everybody that you're happy to be a Jew. Scream, I'm a Jew and I'm proud, whatever it is. Scream, thank you, HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Someone says, who are you? Say, I'm Jewish. I ask what's your name. No, but I'm Jewish first. And then I have a name. Find a way to show that you're happy to be a Jew. Show a way. Now, Hashem sends three people, and he lifted his eyes and saw, and behold, three men were standing over him. He perceived, so he ran towards them from the entrance of the tent, and bowed toward the ground, and he said, my Lord, saying to the angels, if I find favor in your eyes now, please pass not away from your servant. Please, don't leave, don't walk away. It's a hot day. I didn't see people for so long. Please come into my house so I can be mikayim the mitzvah of achnasat ochim, to have guests. Please. What does he say? Let some water be brought and wash your feet and recline beneath the tree. I will fetch a morsel of bread so that you may sustain yourself and then go. Inasmuch as you have passed your servant's way. What do they say to him? They say, do so just as you have said. He says, what does he say? Please, help. Let me do the mitzvah. Please let me do the mitzvah. Let me give you something. Just a small little piece. Just water, just to wash your feet. Just some bread just to eat so that you could regenerate yourself. This is three malachim, the three archangels. Michael, Gabriel, and Raphael, they came to Avraham Avinu to do three missions. Every time an angel comes, they have a mission. What's the mission? Michael came to tell Avraham that he's going to have a son with Sarah. As it says in verse 9, they said to him, "Where is Sarah, your wife?" And he said, "Behold, in the tent." And he says, "I shall surely return to you at this time next year, and behold, Sarah, your wife, will have a son." So he says, that's the first mission of Michael. Then the mission for Gabriel was to go and destroy Sodom. Right after, they were all on a mission, but they said, you know what, might as well come here for now, we'll go with Michael to make Avraham Avinu have the mitzvah of Hachnasat Orchim. They all went together, but that was not all their mission. The mission of Gabriel and Raphael was to go to Sodom. Gabriel was to go to Sodom, and Raphael, he had the mission of healing Avraham Avinu, because he has Refuah means healing, health. And he had another mission of saving Lot from the thing. Now this is all one mission, because this is a mission of rescuing. Raphael was thing of rescue. So he rescued Avraham from sickness, and he rescued Lot from dying, from danger. So going back, what does he say? What does Avraham Avinu say? He says, "Please, Rabotai, please, let me just give you a small little piece of bread. Just something small." And what does he do? What does Avraham Avinu do? He goes over to Sarah. So Avraham hastened to the tent of Sarah and said, "Hurry, 3 seahs of meal, fine flour, knead and make cakes." Then Avraham ran to the cattle, took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the youth who hurried and prepared it. What did he take? He says, "Please, I want you to make a nice, good amount of matzot." So to speak, bread. Matzot, as we have for Pesach. I want you to make matzot. Because the Chachamim explained this was the 15th day of Pesach. This is the 15th day of the month of Sivan, of Nisan. So it was Pesach. It was not yet, because then Pesach didn't happen. But it was going to be. So Avraham Avinu kept that. And he says, today is a holy day. So it was Pesach, so he made matzot. So he made matzot, told Sarah to make matzot. He went and he took animals. Chachamim explained that he took 3 animals, one for each person, for them to have the most delicate parts of the animal. And he took cream and milk and a calf which he prepared, and he placed these before them. He stood over them beneath the tree, and they ate. So over here we have a very important thing. There is a difference between a tzaddik and a rasha. If you're a tzaddik, what do? First, let's say, if you're a rasha, what do? You tell them how much I'm going to do for you. This I'm going to do. And in the end, you do kimat nothing. Almost nothing you do. Maybe you do something small just to say, "See, I did something. At least I did something. Say thank you." So this is a rasha that says, "Aseh arbeh, emor arbeh ve'aseh ma'at." You say a lot, but you do a little. The tzaddikim, what do the tzaddikim do? They say, "Please, let me just help you a little bit. I'm just going to do something small. Let me at least have some small little part in helping you and doing this and doing that." Like if you want to donate to something, say, "Can I please get a few dollars for you?" And they say, "Okay, fine. How much you want to donate?" "Okay, let me donate a few thousand. I thought you were going to donate like $3 or something." Whatever. However much I can give. Tzaddikim say a little bit, just a little bit. You know, act as if it's a quarter. Act as if it's nothing. And then in the end, whenever they do it, they do the whole entire thing. They do. The Chachamim explained, Baba Metzia, page 87a. It says that this meal was bigger than of King Solomon's, than Shlomo HaMelech. Now the question is, what do you mean? There's only three cows. It's a relatively small meal. King Solomon had feasts constantly. He always had meals. He was the king. What is he going to have? Some small little, shawarma? What is he going to have? A small little hummus with the pita and some chicken? What is he going to have? He has a whole entire... He has the chicken just in the... He has three animals each day. Each meal. The Chachamim explains, what does it mean that it's bigger than Shlomo HaMelech? Because in Shlomo HaMelech, they killed three animals, or however many animals, for a lot of people. Each animal was able to feed, five people. And this, over here, Avraham Avinu, he took three cows for three people, meaning a cow for each person. Who's going to eat a cow? Who's going to eat a cow? The biggest person can't eat a cow. It's a huge animal, huge. He's going to eat a cow? He's going to eat a whole entire animal? So this is how the Chachamim explained that this is even bigger meal, bigger banquet than Shlomo HaMelech. So for the Tzaddikim, they say a little bit. They say, please, let me give you a little bit of bread. A morsel of bread so that you may sustain yourself. But what did he do? He gave them a lot of matzot. He gave them whole entire lavish thing of lavish amount of meal, lavish quality of the meat. This is the difference between tzaddikim and rasha'im. The tzaddikim say small, they say I'm going to do this, and then in the end it's a lot of return. It's a lot. The rasha'im say, you know how much I'm going to give you. You know how much I'm going to do. You know who I am. I'm big CEO. I make millions of dollars a year. You say, oh, you know, you sounds good. How much are you going to donate? Oh, maybe $100. But one poor guy, Sadiq, comes and he says, you know, I want to do mitzvah. I want to do tzedakah. How much can I give you? And you look at him, you're like, miskin, okay, fine. Just give a dollar. Give a dollar. You'd be perfectly fine. Hashem looks very highly at that. He has no money. And he says, you know what? It hurts, but I'm going to give. This is like, he's like giving his heart already. And you're like, are you sure you can support yourself? He says, I could support myself. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is the one that gives the money. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is the one that... But this rich guy that has money, he talks big, gives a few dollars. Tisku l'shanim rabot. Goodbye. So, continues. First of all, it says, as we said, Michael was the first one to speak. He says, where is your wife? Avraham says, she's in the tent. Chachamim explained, who's asking? Imagine you come to someone's house. He says, sir, where is your wife? What with my wife? What do you care about my wife? I'm here. Imagine you're in a business meeting. How is your wife? Where is your wife? Where's my wife? We care about my wife. We ask about my wife. Avraham says, she's in the tent. She's in the tent. What is this coming to say? Chachamim says, why did he ask that question? To show and to remind Avraham, to show us how modest you have to be. How modest Sarah Imenu was. Our role model. Our first foremother. You know, the first of our matriarchs, that he said that the Torah teaches right now. We have to see the go after the steps of Sarah. The women have to go after the steps after Sarah. That whenever there are the people, the guys speaking to each other, you're not there. You're not there with them. How is everything? How is your wife? How is your kids? How is your job? What are you speaking to them? The men have to be with the men. The women have to be with the women. Respectfully. Modestly. So Avraham is saying, she's my Eshet Chayil. She's in the room. She's in her own tent. She's preparing herself. She's modest. She's not chilling with the guys. She's not taking the beer and chilling on the couch with the guys. She has modesty. She has class. Class. People forgot about the word class. People forgot about this concept. To have class. To have be a classy woman. To be a classy person. To be modest. Shem Yishmol. Now nobody's... It's rare to be modest. The most modest woman was the Queen Elizabeth. So after Sarah Imenu hears this, it says in verse 12, and Sarah laughed at herself, saying, after I had withered, shall I again have delicate skin? And my husband is so old? Saying, I'm already old, I'm already an old woman. But even my husband's old. How are we going to have kids? How is he going to have a kid? Chas v'shalom. Sarah said it in a very respectful way, but in the end, in her level, it's improper. Chachamim should have said that even if she thought it was just few Arabs in the middle of nowhere saying something, you know, if a mishugana just comes over to you and says, you know, your wife is going to have a kid, and the guy is like thinking, you know, I'm 100 years old. Came out 100 years old, my wife is 90, we're going to have a kid. What does he say? Oh, Bezat Hashem, whatever. And then Avraham Avinu understood that it was divine. But Chachamim said, Sarah, first of all, should have known that it was a prophecy. But in the end, even if she didn't know it was a prophecy, she just heard a random Arab guy says it. What should she have said? Amen ken yotzon. Bezat Hashem. Bezat Hashem, Hashem is going to make it happen. Amen ken yehi ratzon. Maybe so. That's what she would have said. She should have said. And then Hashem comes over to Abraham and says, why is it that Sarah left, saying, shall I in truth bear a child though I have aged? Now what is the difference over here? What did Sarah say? And what did Hashem Yitbarach say back to Avraham Avinu? Sarah said, my husband's old. My husband is old. Hashem comes over to Avraham and says, why did your wife say that she's old? Now the question is, what is this? It's not what Sarah said. So Chachamim, as we know, we have a mitzvah in the Torah. It says, midvel shekir tirchak. You should run away from lies. You should distance yourself away from liars, from lying. And there is Gemarot, not even though it's a very big problem to lie, and there's a very big punishment. It says in the Chot Tzadikim, Shar Shekel, the gate of falsehood, the gate of lies, in the end of the chapter, this is chapter 22 in the book Orchot Tzadikim, which is the ways of the ways of the righteous, the paths of the righteous. Now it says, there are times which the Chachamim explained that it's allowed to lie. Now what type of lie? A white lie, not just a straightforward lie. A white lie, meaning you could butter it a little bit. Water it down. Such as making peace between a man and his neighbor, or a man and his wife. Shalom bayit. You're making shalom, you're making peace. So you could tell a white lie. Avraham, Aaron HaKohen. As it says in the Mishnah, Ohev Shalom, Rodef Shalom, that he used to run after peace, make peace with people, run after peace, try to make peace in the world. He was the epitome of Shalom, he was the epitome of peace. How did he do it? Some guy got into an argument with his friend. Avraham Avinu, Aharon HaKohen, would go over to this person and say, go over to one, go and the other one's over there, you go over to one, he says, listen, the guy spoke to me, he feels bad. He knows deep down, you know, he feels bad. He feels bad what he did. He knows he was wrong. He knows he was everything. He wants to make peace with you. The guy's going to say, Rad, yeah, really? Why didn't he come to me? He feel, you know, it's in the end, it's not so easy. It's not so easy. And then it's hard. But Bemet, he wants to. He has the, okay, fine, maybe I'm going to speak to him. But Bemet, you know, whatever, all these type of things. So he says, okay, fine. So you're gonna speak to him? You're going to forgive him? Yeah, you know, if he really feels it, I'm going to forgive him. And he goes to the other guy. He says, you know, really, he's sorry. He doesn't want to be in fights with you. He wants to do peace with you. Please, you know, speak to him. Have peace with him. He really wants to come over to you and wants to make peace with you. So then they would come together and say, oh, you want to do peace? Yeah, I want to do peace. Yeah, okay, you want to do peace? And then in the end, they did peace. To do peace, is you're allowed to. And it says in Masechet Yevamot 65b. This is likewise, you also, it says in Masechet Ketubot 17a. So, the one before, as we see with Hashem Yitbarach, if he would have said to Avraham, listen, your wife said you were old. Avraham, he was tzaddik, but in the end, it's not proper, it's not nice. You're going to say to someone, listen, your wife just said you were ugly. Or you said to the woman, listen, I heard. Your husband said, you know, you're getting old. It's not proper. It's not nice. So Hashem says sometimes it's better. Watch your mouth. Another place that it's allowed to is whenever it comes to praising a bride in front of the groom. Whenever you're at the wedding, you say, listen, you have no idea how lucky you are. You have no idea, is that, all these type of things. Praising, you know. Says in Masechet Ketubot 17a, says that you cannot say, oh my God, she's ugly, she has this, she has that, she looks like, you know, all these type of things. You can't say this type of thing. You have to say, it says in the Gemara, what if she has a broken arm? What if she doesn't have an arm? What if she has like, she's a Baal Mum? She doesn't have, she has deformities like crazy. Hillel HaZaken explains to Bet Hillel says to Bet Shammai, he says, I want to ask you a question. Before someone buys something, and he asks you, do you think I should buy it? And you look at it, you tell him, you know what, I'm not 100% sure, I don't think you should buy it. So he's going to say, okay, fine, no problem, thank you very much, he's going to put it down. But if he already bought it, and he comes to you and he says, I can't return it, it's, you know, it was expensive, the guy already left, I can't find him, and he says, is it good? Did I make a good purchase? But you're going to look at it and say, nah, you wasted your money. He's going to feel like garbage, and he can't return it, he can't anything. He says, oh, okay, fine, Baruch Hashem, it's good. Because he already bought it, he already acquired this woman. He already got married to her. That's first of all. Second of all, even though he has different tastes than you, you could say she doesn't look good, you could say this, that, but in the end, he got married to her. So in the end, his taste could be different. You say, you lucky man, this, that. This is the times that you use your brain. Also, whenever it comes to being a guest in someone's house, whenever you go to someone's house, you cannot go over to people and start saying, you have no idea how good the food is. The guy, I went to his house, saw the hospitality that he gave to me. He made me feel like a king, made me feel like all these type of things. Great. You cannot say this either. Why? Because it says in the book of Proverbs, in the book of Mishle, chapter 27, verse 14, he who blesses his friend with a loud voice, rising early in the morning, it shall be accounted as a curse to him. This is in Masechet Arachin 16a. Now, in Tractate Bava Metzia, page 23b, it explains and it says that that if someone was busy, it says bepuria, right? If someone was with his wife, he was with his wife, and he was busy at the time. He should be somewhere, but he's busy with his wife. He's with his wife at this time, having relations with his wife. And he comes late to, let's say, learning, comes late to work, comes late to something, or he just comes to something. And someone says, where were you yesterday, the night before, this, that, whatever it is. He shouldn't say, Habibi, I was with my wife. What should he say? Try to think of something else. It's not proper. Don't say these type of things. Say, I was busy. I had something very important. I had an important meeting with someone, with a friend of mine. Some type of white lie. Some type of something that you know, you don't say, I was, whatever. Don't lie completely. You have to keep it connected, but you have to say something else. I was busy. I was preoccupied. I wanted to come, but in the end, something happened. So I said, listen, you gotta tell me. What do I have to tell you? Who are you right now? You're my secretary. You're my boss. Yeah, something happened. Something happened. I had to stay there. Also, if someone asks you, how many masechtot did you finish? How much do you learn? How much do you know? You know, so listen, I know half of the Torah. Do you know? They ask you, do you know this? What do you say? Basically, you could lie about it. You could say no. He says, it says in Orchot Tzedekim, it says, but, however, if you manage without lying, meaning you should do it in a way that's not veering 100% from the truth. Someone asks you, do you know this Masechet? Do you know this tractate? What are you supposed to tell them? It's better to tell them, like, try to go away from the question. Sometimes you could swerve a question. Someone asks a question, you swerve away from the question. So what do you say? He says, do you know this? You look at him, you say, do you really think I know this? You know how long it takes to learn this? You know, you try to veer away from the question. The guy's going to say, like, okay, fine, I'm not going to ask the question. Probably doesn't know. And then, Behemet, you do know. So that's a way of actually veering away from the question. It's saying, if he can put off questioner in this way without lying, it is better that he do so rather than an outright lie. He should follow this practice in all of his affairs. If he does so, happy is he and happy is his begetter. Happy as he is person that gave birth to him. That was Orchot Tzedekim. So it says over here, we see that sometimes you're allowed to tell a white lie. Sometimes we have to understand that it's not always such a straightforward black and white thing. Some people think that there is, for example, you have ego, you have pride, you have even sadness, or you have happiness, or you have cruelty, or you have kindness. Sometimes people think you're never supposed to have any of the bad traits and only have the good ones. But the thing is, sometimes you have to have the bad traits. Sometimes you cannot have the good traits. If you have a murderer coming next to you, you're not supposed to say, oh, come, Habibi, give me a big hug. You're supposed to right now, Chayecha Kodmim, you have to, he is coming to kill you. You have full right, sometimes even an obligation, to right now kill him. Do whatever you have to do. Save your life. What are you coming to kill me for right now? Or if you see Amalek, you have no permission to be kind. No permission whatsoever to be kind. Sometimes, whenever it comes to kids, sometimes, yes, you have to have a very high measure of kindness, of love, of everything. But if you only show love, if you only show, they say, can I have this? Yes. Can I do this? Yes. Abba, can I have this? Yes. Ima, can I have this? Yes. Yes. Always yes. In the end, you're going to make a mini Hitler. This is what happened with David the Melech. With King David. He told Avshalom, yes, 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 yes. In the end, Avshalom says, you know what? Abba, I want to be king. No. What do you mean no? I'm going to kill you. No. What happened? He ran away. Avshalom tried to kill him. Tried to kill his father. He tried to kill his father. So then sometimes you have to say no. Sometimes, many, many times. That's why it's called middot. That's why it's called middot. Why middot? Because it's middot equals out. The translation that we use is character traits, traits. But the actual translation of middot is measures. Because each of these traits, you have to have a measure for it. You have to have a very big measure of kindness, very big measure of happiness, very big measure of humility. But there are sometimes, there is a measurement that you're supposed to have of the quote unquote bad traits. You're supposed to have the pride a little bit. Small measurement, but a little bit. You're supposed to have cruelty a little bit. Sadness a little bit. It's not, you're supposed to be sad. So if Khorban Beit HaMikdash happened, the temple was destroyed, you're supposed to be sad. Every single day we have an obligation to be sad a little bit for a smaller amount of time, just to remember the Beit HaMikdash. Even in a wedding. And at a wedding, does anybody ever think, why did we break a cup? Why did the Jews break a cup? We break a cup not because it's some type of thing to have to do with a marriage. We're getting married today. It's a happy day. Why are we breaking the cup? To remind us, even though you're happy, you have to remember the temple was destroyed. So we're breaking this thing. Technically, people just scream Mazal Tov right away. No, we're supposed to actually wait 3 seconds, whatever it is, think, maybe even cry for a second. Remember what we lost, to be a little sad. We lost the Beit HaMikdash. So, Midot, you're supposed to have measures of it. So even with truth in line, truth, very high, in the end, Midvel Shekel Techak, you have to run away from falsehood. Torah says, run away from falsehood. Like it's a disease. But sometimes, you have to know that sometimes Shekel is a thing that's needed. So Hashem comes over to Avraham and says, I'm going to destroy Sodom and Amora. Sodom and Gomorrah, I'm going to destroy it. Avraham Avinu starts speaking to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And he starts begging HaKadosh Baruch Hu. He says, please HaKadosh Baruch Hu, if there are 50 people in the town, in the kingdom of Sodom, which is actually 5 different towns, 5 different kingdoms, 5 different towns, districts. It's Sodom, Gomorrah, Adma, yeah, Zvayim and Bela. Sodom, Gomorrah, Adma, Zvayim and Bela. These are the 5 towns. 5 towns. Not the 5 towns. So these are the 5 districts. So he says, Hashem Yitbarach, if there are 50, meaning 10 in each district, are you going to destroy it? 50 tzaddikim, just 50, in a town full of Rishayim. 50 tzaddikim, you're going to save it? Hashem is Avraham is begging Hashem. Hashem says, if there are 50, I'm not going to destroy it. He says, unlike Noach, as we said, Noach, Zohar says that he didn't pray for his people. He didn't pray before the Mabul. He didn't pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, please save them. They give them a chance. Give them this. In the end, there's a chance that they can do tshuva and all these type of things. Noach had 120 years and he didn't pray. Until he prayed after the Mabul. He prayed and he cried. Hashem calls him Raya Shatya, you foolish shepherd. Why didn't you cry before? But over here we have to learn from Avraham to pray. To pray for people. To help. To pray. Hashem, please give them time to do tshuva. Please give them time to repent. Rav Moshe Feinstein comes and explains, he says, what is this? Abraham is praying for righteous people, for wicked people? So what is it? Why is he praying for wicked people? He's lav davka, not really praying for the wicked people. He's praying for the wicked people because he knows. He's saying to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he says, Hashem, if there are 10 people in each region, what does that mean? That the wicked people have a chance to do tshuva. They have these 10 tzaddikim that will go around and tell people, bring people back, rebuke the people, tell them what you're doing is wrong, and teach them the right way. They have a chance to do tshuva. Please, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, give them time. Now I know that since there are 10 people in each town, there is a possibility. There's hope. There's hope. Don't lose hope. Hashem, please help. Please save them. Hashem says, if there are 50 people, I'm not going to destroy the city. You're right. And Avraham over here comes in verse 27 and says something beyond, something amazing. What does he say? He says, behold, now I desire to speak to my Lord, although I am but dust and ash. He says, Hashem, I am afar ve'efar, I'm nothing, I'm zero. If you can, if I'm, you know, if you know, to you, to my master, please, if I can speak, please, you have to put yourself low. Avraham Avinu was the epitome of how he said right now over here. He was explaining how he was right, how he was humility. This is where the Jews get the humility that they have to, that they have to be the they have to have this trait, all these traits of Avraham Avinu. We have to have the kindness, the humility. So all traits that we have to have. Avraham Avinu, that he's speaking to God right now. What is he saying? I am dust and ashes. I am afar ve'efer. Rav Nisim again is explaining. He says, why does it say dust and ash? Because dust, what's dust? Dust you could use. Dust, in the end you have dirt. Ani afar, you could take it, you could use it. You could use it to plant, you could use it to something. But Avraham Avinu explained and he saw, he says, wait 1 second. No, I'm not afar. I'm not dust. Ani efel. Efel, ash, you can't do anything with it. It's completely worthless. So first he was saying, ani afal. No, ani efel. I am complete garbage. I am nothing. I am ash. You can't even do anything. You're just in the wind. There's nothing there. That's how humble he was. Now what did he get from this humble humility? Hashem says, how can I destroy the town without speaking to my lover, to my dear son, Avraham? That he goes in my ways. So, goes down and he says, if I have the ability, please, maybe there's 40, there's 45. He says, no, maybe there's 40. No, maybe there's 30. Maybe what if there's 20? What if there's 10? Chachamim Be'emet explained there wasn't even one. There was no tzaddikim over there. It was all nothing. There's nothing there. So, the question is, what was the problem? Why did Hashem want to destroy Sodom so badly? So it explained that Be'emet, they were very wicked. They were wicked. In Masechet Sanhedrin, page 109a. And 109b. What does it say? It says the verse, Ve'anshe Sodom ra'im v'chata'im la'ashem me'od. This is in Genesis 13:13. Now what does it mean? It says, Ra'im, evil, with their bodies. Chataim, sinful, with their money. So there are in the Gemara, in the Talmud, Masechet Sanhedrin, page 109a. It goes into different, the whole entire list of different things that they used to do, that they were like unbelievable, the type of law that they had over there. There was one, first of all, they were very, very against having any type of guests. You invite a guest, death penalty. It's avera in Sodom. Bet din posek halakha prohibited, asur, to have any guests, to show any mercy to poor people, to show any mercy to people that need help. So they said, they made a rule, they said anybody that invites people to a wedding, they're going to take away the person that invited them, they're going to take them and they're going to strip them down, they're going to take away their clothes. So one time, Eliezer, so the Eliezer goes to the wedding and they ask him, excuse me, sir, who are you again? Ah, I'm Eliezer. So, okay, who invited you? Because they wanted to know who to right now rape, who to embarrass. So Eliezer goes over to me and says, you invited me. He's screaming, you invited me. And the guy gets, excuse me, what? He says, yeah, you invited me. And he's saying it loud so people hear. And that guy gets so scared, he's saying, he doesn't know what to do. Because if he says, no, I didn't invite you, maybe he's just saying it just for him not to get in trouble. So the guy is like, okay. He runs away, he runs out of there, and another person comes, who invited you? You did! The guy runs away, everybody's scared, everybody comes over to him, who invited you? You. Everybody's scared, because then maybe he's going to start believing. People are going to believe him, and then they're going to charge someone that's not guilty. There was also another thing that basically the only time, there's a few exceptions how you could invite guests. If you invite a guest, you have to give him a big bed. And what's a big bed? They have to give a big bed. If he's big, you give him a small bed. If he's small, you give him a big bed. Now, what's the big deal? Okay, if you're big and you get a small bed, okay, fine. Your legs are gonna stick out or whatever. Okay, fine. It's gonna be uncomfortable. But if you're big, if you're small and you get a big bed, what's the big deal? So the thing is, if you were small, they would stretch you out until you fit the big bed. If you were small and your legs are sticking out, okay, fine, no problem. We're not gonna cut off your legs. Now there was also a halakha in Sodom. Halakha in Sodom that they said that they made a halakha that if someone hits a person and the person goes over to the Beit Din, goes over to the judge in Sodom and says, look what this guy did to me, he hurt me. I'm bleeding now because of him. What is the judge going to say? The judge is going to say, okay, good. So now you pay him. Excuse me, what do I have to pay him? He says, pay him because he did a service to you. So what service did he do to me? He was doing bloodletting. Now bloodletting back in the day was a very big thing for healing. They used to do it all the time. You have any type of sickness, bloodletting. We're gonna take out some blood from you. So they said, he did a service to you, so you have to pay him. What do you mean? He hit me on my head. He says, yeah, he took out some blood from you, he did you a service, you have to pay him. Now, one time Eliezer was in Sodom, and someone hits him on the head. He takes him to Beit Din. He says, what is this? Judge, prosecute this man. The judge says, no, you actually have to pay him. So why do I have to pay him? Because he did a service for you. So Eliezer says, oh yeah, okay, fine. He takes a rock, he throws it at the judge's head. The judge starts bleeding. He says, what would you do this for? He says, the money that you owe me, pay it to him, and my money is going to stay with me. So this was a thing of Sodom. Now there was also another story, how it says, Havyahi Ravita. There was a certain woman that they saw that there was if there was ever any poor people in Sodom, they would wait until he dies and eventually, okay, throw his body in the pit, steal all his goods, steal his clothes, steal whatever type of small things that he has, and throw his body in a bury his body. So there was one poor person that nobody was giving, no one had pity on him. But there was this one girl. There's one girl, who's this girl? Lot's daughter. Lot's daughter, Chachamim explained that her name was Paltit. Paltit, her name was, that she went and she had pity on this man, and secretly she would go with the pail, with the bread in her in a small pail so nobody sees. In the middle of the night she would go and give it to this poor man. Every night. Days are passing. They're seeing this guy. Who's this guy? This guy is immortal. He just doesn't eat. How is he still alive? He's supposed to die a while ago. How is he still alive? He says, "Bevadai, someone's feeding him. It's obvious someone's feeding him. We have to check this." So they scouted out. They were waiting. They were looking, and they saw this girl bringing bread. They caught her. They say, "What are you doing? You're doing a crime." They brought her to the Beit Din. They say, "You have death penalty." What did they do? They took her and they did a very, very strange death. What did they do? They covered her with honey completely. They covered her with honey and they let all the bees and all the wasps and everything consume her body and sting her and everything until she died. She died a horrible death. That's how much they didn't allow people, they didn't have hospitality in Sodom. Now this is all, you look into, okay, fine, crazy people. But what's an even crazier thing? As we know, Sodom, what's the thing that it was known for, the greatest thing, is all their immorality. As we have, it's a very interesting thing, that actually the word for homosexuality is called sodomy. Why? Because it's named after Sodom. Named after Sodom. So much so that if we actually go back to the thing, we go to the story of whenever they came to Lot's house. Lot also prayed, he learned from Abraham. He says, "Please come to my house." "What do you mean come to my house? You're gonna die, they're gonna kill you. You're not allowed to have guests." "Please come to my house. I'll make you a big meal. I'll do everything for you." They come. And what does it say? They had not yet lain down when the townspeople, the Sodomites, converged upon the house from young to old, all the people from every quarter. Meaning people came to the house. They knew he had guests. They came to the house. You know, riots. And they called to Lot and said, "Where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us so that we may know them." What do you mean we may know them? It says, "Vinid'a otam." Now, if you look in Tanakh, every single time whenever it says "de'a," whenever it comes between a person and another person, it's usually speaking about marital relations. That's why it speaks about whenever with Adam and Chava, that he knew Chava, or we see so many times that he knew his wife. What do you mean he knew his wife? Meaning that he was with her. So they're coming, they say, "Let them come out so that we can know them." What does that mean? They wanted to rape the angels. They wanted to rape the guests. Come, let's, you know, this how deprived they were. They didn't even say it quietly, privately. They said it out in the open. Get your guests out so we can rape them. This is how so deprived they were. Now, a very interesting thing. So what does it say? What does Lot say? Even though he learned from Abraham the to have misirut nefesh for guests, what did he say to them? He says, I beg of you, my brothers, don't act wickedly. See now, I have two daughters who have never known a man. I shall bring you out to them. Do as them as you please. But to these men, do nothing, inasmuch as they have come under my shelter of my roof. He learned the misirut nefesh to be to have hospitality for guests. But what did he do? He had a messed up brain that he said, no, that my guests stay here. But if you want, you can have my daughters, right? Do whatever you want to my daughters, Hashem Yishmor. He didn't understand the what it is to have respect for your own family, to have respect, to have, you know, modesty, to have a self-image of your family. Because in the end, he learned from the people. In the end, he was strong enough, but he still learned. He still learned a lot from the people of Sodom. Now, what's a very strange one? A strange halakha of Sodom. This is halakhot of Sodom. Halakhot of Sodom. Shulchan Aruch, Sodom. Talmud, Sodomi. What does it say? They explained that if a person, you have a pregnant woman, that she's on the street, she's walking, someone comes and hits her, punches her, let's say in the stomach, chas v'shalom, punches her in the stomach, wants to hit her, and what happens? The baby gets miscarried. The baby is miscarried. Now you have a person that punched a woman, according to Bet Din, according to Jewish law, even Noahides, if a non-Jew would come and punch someone and the baby is miscarried because of that, this person deserves death penalty. We would have to kill him. But what does the Bet Din of Sodom say? He says, wait one second, let's put this into perspective. This woman had a child. This guy took the child away from him, from her. What is that considered? That's thievery. That's thievery. So what does he have to do? He has to pay it back. How is he going to pay it back? What do? They go over to the husband. They say, Señor, your wife had something and this guy stole it. He has to give it back. What does that mean? He has to return what she had. Meaning he has to, the guy that hit her, doesn't make a difference if it's her husband. Doesn't make a difference if it's her brother. Doesn't make a difference if it's her son. Doesn't make a difference. She's married. Could be her brother for all of them. It could be a forbidden relationship, close family, close something, whatever it is. Does it make a difference who it is? This person has to return, the criminal has to return the baby to her, has to be with her and make her pregnant. This is halakha of Sodom. Does it make a difference who she is, who he is, what's their relationship? The guy has to be with her. This is the depravity of Sodom. Now, I'm going to stop the shiur now. This parasha is filled. It could be a lot of other things to talk about. As we know, Akedat Yitzhak over here, we have how Sarah gets abducted again, and Abraham tells them, Avimelech says, why didn't you tell me? Why didn't you tell me she's your wife? He says, because I saw there's no fear of God over here. There's no fear of God. And so he says, no, that's how we learn that if someone doesn't have fear of God, you cannot be alone with him. Why? Because he might kill you. He might kill you. That's how high it goes. That's how much it goes. That how important it is to have the fear of God. To have Yirat Shamayim. And there's a lot of other things we could that could be learned out, that could be learned. I highly suggest for every person to read the parasha. Read the parasha. Read the parasha. This is, I'm going to say it, this is from the book of Genesis, chapter 18, until chapter 23. From 18, not including 23, until 23. Read it, learn from it, learn the ethics behind it, learn the laws from it, learn what to do, how to act. And Bezat Hashem, we will have, we saw the difference between the middot of Avraham Avinu, the middot of what it means to be Jewish, what it means to be a man of God, what it means to have a straight mind, straight person, straight everything, straight hashkafa, and the halachot of Sodom, the people of Sodom, Lot's hashkafa, Lot's ideology, the people of Sodom's ideology. Bezat Hashem, we will be able to grasp, we will be able to grab and be and put into ourselves the midot of Avraham Avinu and not the midot of Sodom. Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen ve'amen.